This was a week where the problems of so-called fake news, often just a name for an out-and-out lie or unproven claim, were evident once again, and this time led to alarming consequences. Hari Sreenivasan joins us from our New York studio tonight with a look at the latest concerns and the beginning of a periodic series on the subject.
Viral conspiracy theories masquerading as news spread at incredible speeds throughout the election cycle across social platforms like Facebook, Reddit, Twitter, and 4chan. But on December 4th came a very real measure of their impact. A 28-year-old man from North Carolina entered Comet Ping Pong Pizza in Washington, D.C., armed with an assault rifle, claiming he wanted to, quote, self-investigate a fast-spreading theory. Edgar Madison Welch, seen here with his arms up, was intrigued by the totally false conspiracy theory that the pizzeria was part of a child abuse ring led by Hillary Clinton and her former campaign manager. After aiming at an employee and discharging a weapon, he surrendered to authorities. Luckily, everyone inside escaped unharmed. This week, more fallout from what has been dubbed as Pizzagate. The Trump transition team removed Michael Flynn Jr., the son of the man President-elect Trump wants as his national security advisor, after it became clear that Flynn Jr. was retweeting this and other conspiracies.
Thank you.
Hillary Clinton, herself the target of other lies spread over the web repeatedly, weighed in during one of her few public appearances since the election.
It's now clear that so-called fake news can have real-world consequences. This isn't about politics or partisanship. Lives are at risk. Lives of ordinary people just trying to go about their days to do their jobs, contribute to their communities.
Technology companies like Facebook and Google say they are working to tackle the proliferation of fake news. One way has been to decrease the incentives for advertising that appears on these sites. Sheryl Sandberg, the COO of Facebook, on Thursday's Today Show.
We've taken important steps, but there's a lot more to do. We know that people don't want to see hoaxes on Facebook, and we don't want to see hoaxes on Facebook.
According to a BuzzFeed News investigation, many fake news sites are built purely for profit, sometimes even created by opportunistic teens in far-off places like Macedonia, regardless of the content, because more clicks lead to more dollars.
What's motivating the rise of fake news, and what tools are tech companies developing to stop its spread? As part of a series of conversations, I'm joined by Marc Fisher of The Washington Post, who wrote one of the deeper dives into how this baseless story spread so fast and how it almost ended in tragedy. Marc, this is one of the first stories that I think drew a connection for people that virtual hoaxes have real-world consequences.
Well, they absolutely do. And we saw this when a gunman walked into the pizza place that was the subject of this false rumor about a supposed sex ring that Hillary Clinton and John Podesta, her campaign chairman, were running in a residential neighborhood pizza place in Washington, D.C. And what we were able to do was to kind of trace this back to patient zero, looking back to how did this spread and why did it spread? And what we found was a combination of people who had a profit motive and people who were really quite innocently running across this story and deciding that it was concerning to them and they wanted to know more about it.
You know, that's one of the things that people are going to wonder about is, well, how do you not see the falsehood in this, or how do you press share, or, you know, how do you end up kind of perpetrating this lie further and further? What were the answers that people were giving you?
You know, I think there's a tendency to dismiss the people who spread these stories as uneducated or simply not understanding the technology they're dealing with. Anything but the case. They tend to be quite educated people. They tend to be people who are very well connected online. And what they're stumbling into sometimes, first of all, there's kind of a loss of trust. So if you look at the whole diminution of trust across society about government, about the news media, people are looking for alternative ideas and alternative sources. And that's why they're open to these kinds of stories that they find online. And then once they find them, what I found in talking to the people who've spread the message most widely is that they were kind of caught up in the fun of this. To them, it was kind of a game, a serious game, because they thought they were saving children who were being held in this underground sex ring, but kind of a game where they were really enjoying the hunt And that thrill of the chase is really very similar to what's most satisfying about doing journalism, but without the responsibility part. And that's the part where they say, well, you know, it's reminiscent of what Silicon Valley executives used to say years ago, that the internet is a self-correcting mechanism. A lot of the people who are involved in this believe that, and they're not really keeping at front of mind the real-world damage, such as a gunman showing up to conduct his own investigation.
You know, so what you're kind of describing is almost a large-scale game of Clue being played by thousands of people. I'm aging myself with a reference to that game. But, you know, tell us a little bit more about the people who are doing this for a profit motive.
Well, there is that side of things. And so some people are doing it for political reasons, and some people are doing it for profit. And you find some of these, an extraordinary amount of the traffic online about Pizzagate, this rumor, was going through odd places, Vietnam, Macedonia. What's going on there is that people are setting up sites and setting up bots, which algorithms that are used to spread a message or to retweet something many, many times. And they do this because the more they can get people coming to their site, the more advertising revenue they get from the big social media companies. So there is a profit that can be made by taking something, however fantastic or incredible, and putting it out there in such a way that it goes viral, and then all of that web traffic, all of those clicks, turn out to translate into dollars.
You know, just recently, Facebook and Google tried to take a little bit of those dollar incentives away from these fake news sites. But other than that, what else are they doing? What else can they do?
Well, they can do a lot more than they're doing. And the reason we're able to say that is we look across the ocean to Europe, where they are doing more under pressure from governments there that don't have our same system of First Amendment guarantees and don't have the kind of freedom that our internet companies have as a result of the exemption that absolves them from responsibility for the content that they have on their sites. That's from the 1996 Telecommunications Act. In Europe, without those legal strictures, there's a different kind of legal system involved, where these companies are now being required to remove derogatory material about people from their sites, and they're having to do that. So they clearly know how to do that. They choose not to in this country, in part because it's very expensive to have editors and producers who are going through and making sure that the material that's on their site is responsible. The internet companies tend to say, that's not our responsibility. This is purely a matter for the users to express themselves however they wish. But, you know, if you think about the rest of our economy, there's no other product, there's no other news product or even physical product where the maker says we have no responsibility for what we make. That is just the nature of our commerce. We expect companies that produce things to take responsibility.
So how does it change the landscape of journalism? I mean, so there's definitely a line of thought that says, you know what, just by us labeling this quote-unquote fake news, instead of calling it outright lies or conspiracy theories, that we're elevating it to a status of respect and credibility that it doesn't deserve. I mean, the idea of yellow journalism has existed since the late 1800s. I mean, it helped us get into the Spanish-American War.
Sure, and conspiracy theories have been around since the dawn of civilization. There are biblical admonitions against them, and so that's always been there, probably always will be. So the problem is not really the fake news or the speech itself. The problem is the way it's being spread. It's being spread more quickly and more widely through technology than ever before, and that's the part that we haven't gotten a handle on. So what is the role for traditional journalism? Obviously fact-checking, obviously trying to build up our credibility so that people do see that there are places that can be trusted. But we do happen to live in a time when trust is at a relative low. And we've seen this in periods of economic trouble and political trouble in our country after the Kennedy assassination and now after the 2008 crash. And so during those periods, people do look for alternative sources, and that's what's happening now.
All right, Marc Fisher of The Washington Post, one of many conversations we'll be having on this topic. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.